fresh out the box.
Fresh California plums.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Fresh Film Fridays, the podcast where two dudes spin a wheel every other week. It chooses the newest streaming movies and we discuss them. Today we're talking about 2021's Dune, which was directed by Denis Villeneuve, which is now streaming on HBO Max. I'm your co-host, Alec.
I'm Justin.
And theaters. Sorry, and theaters, most importantly.
You're like, that we spin a wheel, except when we watch something we want to, and we just override the wheel.
No, this time was real. We did choose Dune this time.
Yeah, I know. You're like, welcome to Wheel of Horror, where like we kind of just alter it if we want to.
It's like, listen, we make the fucking... No, this is Fresh Film Fridays. We make the goddamn rules.
Yeah,
there's no wheel.
Eric's not used to Fresh Film Fridays, but the only rule is that there are no rules.
goddamn right, Justin. But today, I think we're talking about the best movie I've seen in like years, man.
Yeah. Like, I've been thinking for the past like week, like I haven't actually taken notes on the film. I always usually take notes, and I like couldn't like put my thoughts into... I felt like I would have like written a book essentially on my thoughts of it.
Yeah.
But it was great, dude.
Dude, there's so much to talk about. And I know you and I, like, we couldn't even control ourselves right after we saw it. We're like playing Halo. We're like, we gotta talk. I barely remember that conversation. So I think we can, we can start fresh now. Yeah, man, this is like for me, and this is, you know, whatever's gonna sound weird, but like, this is probably the closest I can imagine to like Star Wars 1977, like seeing a movie that just blows you away and you're so excited for the next one. You want to talk about it with your friends. And like, I'm so happy this movie exists.
Yeah, I thought you were gonna say something else. Be like, I saw this movie and I asked myself, is this what love is? No, I completely agree, dude. Like, I've been trying to think, and I wanted to ask you. This movie technically came out, I guess it's still like what, COVID period still.
Oh, we're still in hell. Yeah, yeah.
In the past 2 years, since there's been like lockdowns and everything, can you think of any movie off the top of your head that even comes close to this?
No, the only other movie that even comes close to this in like excitement and happiness was Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and that was like 5 or 6 months before COVID. So since then, no. Mm. No.
Yeah, dude. And like, I think everyone knows the past 2 years have been like notoriously like poor films have been released. I don't know if they were rushed or people are doing shit like remotely, but like this movie just like made up for all that.
Yeah, man. I mean, I know they were filming this, I think, in 2019 and stuff. So like they did, you know, they I think they got this finished before COVID. It was supposed to come out last October. And then they're like, no, we want this to be in theaters. Because also, like, I didn't see it in theaters and I'm pissed I didn't. I wanted to see this in theaters. But, you know, you do what you can right now. Dude, it's like the special effects in this movie were so good. It makes me like afraid. What's it going to be in 10 years, dude? Like, really?
Yeah, man. This movie got technically released on Friday,
yeah,
last on week. HBO Max or HBO Go or whatever it's called, Max. And I forgot what I was doing that night. I got off work, I went to the gym, and I saw that it was getting released at midnight, or maybe it was 11. And I was like, I watched an hour of it, and then I think we recorded a podcast, and I was like, I have to finish it. I was up to like 3 a.m. I was like, I have to finish this.
Yeah, no, seriously, there hasn't been a movie like that in a long time either, where I'm willing to stay up until basically 3 a.m. and wasn't falling asleep. I was so like engaged, but very good. Also, they did something weird, I guess, like talking about the actual movie. They did something strange in the beginning before you even see the Warner Brothers logo. They say that quote where it's like, dreams are messages from the deep. And it's like said in that other language. Do you notice that?
Oh, I did see that, but it like, I don't know, it didn't click.
Dude, I was like, that's crazy. They did that before the actual Warner Brothers logo came up. I was like, damn, I've never seen that in a movie before.
Yeah, Warner Brothers was basically like, hey, whatever, just pay us. Like, you do whatever you want.
Seriously, yeah. I think that's, I don't know. I feel like Warner Brothers is finally like, we have a huge hit and a huge franchise on our hands now. And
oh, dude, I mean, like we talked about on Halo, I didn't know that there were 6 of these books.
Oh, yeah.
I knew there was like 1 or 2, and I didn't even know that this was technically part 1 of the book. So like you told me there's going to be 2 movies that are technically book 1. And dude, I was just thinking to myself, like, if this does as good as I think it will financially, they're definitely going to make more. They're not going to not make more. Mm-hmm. And if every single one is as good as this, which, you know, if usually when there's like 2, 3, 4 movies, usually one of them is like notoriously the not as good one. But if they make 6 movies that are almost as good as this, that's going to be quite a series.
Do you know anything about the guy that like kind of helms the whole project, Denis Villeneuve? Do you know anything about him?
You told me some things, but I kind of forgot.
Well, basically, he's like a Canadian filmmaker who's been working for a while. He's 54 years old, but he's made, God, maybe 10 movies. But the first one that I really noticed him for was Sicario. Do you ever see that?
Oh yeah, that was great.
Yeah, so he directed Sicario, then he directed Arrival, which also I loved with Jeremy Renner and
Yeah, that was good.
yeah, and then you got Blade Runner 2049, which, dude, it's like the sleeper hit of the century. It's such a good movie that nobody fucking saw, which sucks.
The new Blade Runner?
Yeah, Blade Runner 2049.
I don't know, man. I feel like, well, first of all, I don't know why a lot of people didn't see it because it has a lot of known actors in it, like Batista's in it and friggin' Ryan. Isn't Ryan Gosling in it?
Yeah, he's the lead.
Yeah, it didn't do well.
No, dude, it did terribly. It was like one of the biggest flops of the year. So the budget was 185 million and it made 250 at the box office. Like, so for them, they thought this was going to be like their Dune, and it was not.
That's interesting. I'm curious why that happened. I know I told you, I was like, oh, I want to watch the original one to like compare it. And you were like, you don't, just don't do that.
Did you?
No, I wanted to, but it's like on my list, but like, I'm almost afraid that it'll like kind of take away from this a bit.
I'll put you this way. Like, I love David Lynch. He's the one that directed it, and Kyle MacLachlan. The cast is great, but dude, it's like, here's the thing. This movie needs two movies to make it make sense, you know, where that version is like 2.5 hours long and it's the entire first book. So it's like they're just crammed way too much in. It's very confusing. So it flopped big time to the point where David Lynch actually had them remove his name in the film. So it's like directed by somebody else now. And even more interesting, he turned down directing Return of the Jedi to direct the original Dune film. Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, if you know anything about like the origins of Star Wars, not to get off topic, but when George Lucas like first wrote the script,
Yeah.
people were like, this won't do well, this is stupid. And then clearly, you know, they're wrong. But,
Oh, yeah.
and Dune was already a well-established, like one of the greatest sci-fi books. So I'm sure they were like, well, if you like the book, you'll like the movie. And then they were like, let's put in a bunch of freaking huge actors and Sting and it'll do great. But, I'm not sure if like two-part movies were a thing back in the 80s. So.
I don't think they would have taken the risk of being like, all right, well, we'll let you do one that ends abruptly and hope that people come back. Because if you look at like A New Hope, even that ends very, it ends with finality. Like, it's like, okay, they destroyed the Death Star, Darth Vader got away, but like, you know, the day is saved. Where this Dune ends in the middle of nothing.
Dude, it was like it ended where they were walking in the desert, and like I like nervously clicked pause on the remote because like I knew in my heart what I was gonna see, and it was like 5 minutes left, and I was like, no.
Dude, but isn't that like, doesn't that make you happy though that like you liked a movie that much that you were angry when it's over?
Yeah, dude, and especially because I read a bunch of reviews, but I read this one review that really stood out to me, and it was like, even though this movie was like 2 hours and 45 minutes long, like it basically said at no point did it feel that long,
No.
and like he just didn't want it to end essentially. And like 2 days after I finished it, I read online that they were approved for the second one, which will I think release December of 2023. So I mean, I'm assuming they haven't stopped filming, you know, they just keep going. But I'm happy they're doing another one.
Dude, if they didn't do another one, that would have been like the biggest cliffhanger. You'd just be like, come on, like 20 years later we get like the sequel or something. But yeah, I don't know. It was definitely strategic though for the director, because he was like, I will do this, but only if I can do it in two parts, because otherwise it's going to be just like the 1984 version. It's not going to work. And Warner Brothers agreed to it, but it is interesting that they didn't green light both of them. Like, you know, Lord of the Rings, that trilogy was already greenlit before they even started filming. This, they're like, well, we'll call it part one. You can market it as part one, but like, hey, if this fucking thing flops just like Blade Runner, we're not doing a part two, so.
Well, I'm sure there was some hesitancy towards that, but even though it was technically half of the first book and it was almost 3 hours long, like there was still so much information that it was hard to like absorb it all. Like I watched it the first night. Sarah watched only an hour of it and then went to bed, and I was like, "Hey, do you want to finish it?" So I watched it technically Thursday and Friday.
Yeah.
Just as excited both times to watch it, and even after finishing it the second time, I was like, "Dude, that movie was so good."
Yeah, I finished it last night and it was the same way. I just couldn't get over the acting, dude. I mean, the acting was so good. Everybody.
Like, what a stellar cast, dude. Like, it was just so, not only were there so many big name actors, but like, they played their roles that they had so well. Like, I'm not like the biggest Jason Momoa fan, but I thought he did great.
Really? I feel like you would be the biggest Jason Momoa fan.
I mean, I'll watch movies with him where he's like, you know, beating the crap out of people because he's a big dude. But like, you know, Jason Momoa is no Leonardo DiCaprio, you know?
I've actually never really seen him in anything aside from Game of Thrones. So I'm always kind of just like, whatever. I liked him in this. I thought he was like charismatic. I thought he was like, I don't know. He felt like the big brother everybody always wanted. And then he's badass as fuck.
Yeah.
But I did not like his name. I think Duncan Idaho is a pretty stupid name.
Yeah, what? Like, I missed a lot of people's names because honestly, like I said, it was so hard. So much was going on and I was like captivated by like the music in between each scenes and like the camera angles and shit. But yeah, Duncan Idaho is like, who the hell okayed that? Like,
yeah.
It had to have been a joke. Like they were on stage and they were like, hey, Duncan. They're like, haha, that's so stupid.
Like, well, no, because it is from the 1965 novel. So like that is real. But it reminds me of like Johnny Utah. So I'm like, when are we going to get the Johnny Utah Point Break like spinoff with Duncan Idaho as his like partner? I don't know.
But yeah, everyone did good. I always forget his name. The guy who played Poe or the King.
Oh, Oscar Isaac.
Yeah, I thought he was great. Yeah. And I was so upset that like they killed off like three or four big name actors that I really liked. But just the fact that a movie can do that in the first half of the first book, like you could just tell it's going to be good if they continue to do this.
Well, it reminded me of Game of Thrones, where it was like, it feels like Ned Stark is kind of like Oscar Isaac's character. It's Leto Atreides is his name, but yeah, where he gets killed, you're like, no, like his house is getting destroyed, all this stuff. It feels like Game of Thrones, kind of.
There were a lot of Game of Thrones, Star Wars things that I picked up. Like you said, the different houses and the betrayals. The Star Wars thing, like the giant worm reminded me of the Sarlacc pit. There were a lot of things. But obviously, like when a book is written in that time, like in the 80s, it's taking, you know, the writer is taking from pieces of things that he likes and just kind of making it his own.
This is from the 60s. This is way older, but what inspired Frank Herbert was I think he was living in Oregon, and there was these dunes up there that were like with windstorms destroying houses. People were like trying to live there, but there was such heavy sandstorms all the time. And what they did is they like planted bushes and stuff over the sand to like manipulate the earth so that they could live there. And he was like, why shouldn't we just live with the sand and the dunes and all of this stuff? And then he started thinking about like, okay, what do governments do? They go in and change things. They take natural resources. The Fremen live in harmony with it. And he was like thinking about the conflict of that. And then, dude, you look at like Arrakis, Iraq, oil, spice. There's like all these little connections. So I think he was writing about sort of what the Middle East in the 70s, in the 60s. And then
like spice was oil.
Oh, yeah. I think spice is definitely oil in, I don't know, the metaphor for it, I guess.
Okay. I definitely caught on to some of that, but dude, just like the story, I'm very interested to see who this emperor is, who, if like I'm understanding it, is in charge of like these different planets of like civilizations. Like there's like the Dune people, and then there's like the king, where like Poe was the king of that planet and the emperor kind of oversees it all. The way I looked at it was like an honor for the Arrakis people to like kind of take over Dune and do the spice harvesting.
Well, it's a double cross. So basically the emperor, the Harkonnen, the people like Batista and Bill Skarsgård, those characters, they were the overlords of Dune, Arrakis, for years. And they were taking all of the spice and making all this money and stuff like that. And then the emperor is like, all right, here's what we're going to do. You guys are going to leave. I'm going to say that, like, you know, I don't really know why, but he's like, you're going to leave. We're going to put a Atreides down there. They're going to take it over. And then right when they take over, we're going to kill them. And then that's it. So we don't know why the emperor is betraying Atreides and that whole family. We don't know.
Who was the other army that the Arrakis people like hired?
So they're called like the Sadarkhan or something like that. And they're the emperor's like army. So they're his like personal sort of army or whatever.
Oh, wow.
So they're also, that's basically the even double bigger betrayal.
A double cross?
It's a super double, you know, Omegatron.
It's cross. A quadruple cross.
Because what's happening is the Emperor is like, okay, it's going to make it look like the Harkonnen are attacking Atreides, but also now we're going to send my personal army too. So it's like, hey, you're fucked and we're all fucking you together right now. So yeah, so then they expected Paul to survive. I mean, they expected Paul to die, but he didn't. So he escapes. So now their family lineage can live on. And you see Paul having all these visions of like people fighting over his name. So it's going to get out what happened now because Paul survived. And so did Jessica. So it's like, oh, shit. So like that didn't go according to plan 100%.
From the movie, like the people, what are they called? Like Poe's people?
They're the Atreides.
Okay, the Atreides. Like it looks like they took like a small fraction of their army because, you know, they didn't really have any enemies because he said he was going to align himself with the Dune people.
Yeah.
Because they're like strong warriors. I'm not sure what his intentions were to have those extra people, but maybe just not to fight them. And dude, they just were like massively outnumbered when the other armies attacked. Like it was not, they knew they were going to die. Like when Josh Brolin was like with me, he was like, it's not looking good.
Well, think about it, dude. It's like you're not expecting a double cross. You're like, hey, we're going to go there, inhabit this new area, start to figure out what the hell's going on, learn from the people there, explain our intentions when we get there. And then right when you land, they're like, actually, we're going to fuck you right now. So he wasn't expecting that, you know?
Right. Yeah, that's why he didn't take a large part of his army. But I'm curious, like, first off, I found it very funny that they have like space travel and like all this body armor shield technology, but like they're still using swords and melee weapons.
Oh, I can tell you why. So, dude, I went crazy deep with this shit. So basically, at some point in history, there was like a technological jihad where they destroyed all AI and, you know, it was basically like the Terminator happened in this universe. So they don't have, if you notice, there's like no computers, there's no AI, there's nothing like that in this movie. And what happens is they make these shields and guns don't work on them. They just bounce right off. So what they have to do is they have to use close combat knives to stab into the shield and then break through it. So guns don't work. That's why they don't use guns.
Okay, that's pretty cool. And it also adds to the whole like badass, like you can't just shoot someone. Like you have to go up and fight them and your skill to kill them.
100%. It's honor.
I was a little confused about how the shields work. So it, like if someone hits you with a sword, it won't go through the shield, but you have to like pierce it and then they're vulnerable. Is that it?
It's basically like if it's like a quick hit, like a, you know, just a smack on the arm, it'll turn blue. But if you hit it and like continue to press down really hard, like, you know, if it was a real sword, then it would turn red and that actually penetrates the shield and hits the skin. The dart is a good example where it goes into the back of Leto's back and it's like freaking out for a second because it can't penetrate it. And then eventually it's like, and it breaks through eventually.
Yeah, dude, I was wondering how that little dart got through. And I'm mad because I know the Emperor or the king or whatever, like, didn't think he was in danger at all. But like there was an assassination attempt on his son. I would have thought like he would have had guards with him. Like he was just by himself walking around. And if he had guys with him, he may have lived.
Yeah, well, he did have guards, but they got taken out because he says like guards, and they're not coming. And then he gets hit by the thing, and he finds that woman on the ground. She's like, and she's like bleeding or whatever. Dude, that guy, that UN guy, the doctor who betrays everybody, that guy's the biggest fucking piece of shit, dude. Like, think about what he did. Think about what he did, dude.
He essentially got like killed so many people and overthrew because he was like, oh yeah, the Arrakis king said he's gonna like set my wife free. Like, did you really think he's gonna set him free?
Dude, it's like, he's like, I lowered the shields, I captured their king, I did all this stuff. It's like, so, you know, you're going to set my wife free now. He's just like, yeah, fuck it, fucking kill you. I don't give a shit about you. Like, that was so dumb. I was like, come on.
That was annoying because I feel like he could have just told his king, like, look, dude, these bad guys have my wife. Like, can you talk to the Emperor?
Maybe. Right. Yeah.
Like, imagine if he just called the Emperor, like, hey, man, like, hope I didn't bother you, but like, he's holding my guy's wife hostage.
Yeah. A lot of people think that the wife is that spider thing that's like drinking out of the bowl that the Bene Gesserit yells at to like, get out.
Oh, shit. The spider thing?
Because it says, she's like, they take my wife apart like she's a doll. And they're like, oh, shit. Like, people are thinking that spider thing is the wife that they, like, manipulated and turned to, like, a fucking monster.
Oh, jeez. Okay.
So, we don't know. It's a speculation. But speaking of the Bene Gesserit, dude, That idea is so cool to me, man. That order of women that are like working their way through history, like sleeping with certain men to like enhance their power to bring back the Messiah and stuff. Like,
they're essentially like using their abilities to try and manipulate the future by like, you know, she was like the queen or the mother was mad that the queen had a son because apparently they didn't want a son who was going to be in charge of that planet to also have like the word power where he can talk and like make people do stuff.
Well, not exactly. The problem was they have the ability to, if they can choose if they want to have a boy or girl. And this entire like sisterhood has decided we're only going to have women until we know for a fact we can have this Messiah child. And then Jessica did this in private. And she had a son because she's like, I think we're ready. And Leto is like, I want a son more than anything and blah, blah, blah. So they have Paul and then she starts teaching Paul. So it's almost like she like jump starts the Messiah thing on her own. So now what's happening is he goes to Arrakis and people are seeing like, oh, my God, the second coming is here of whatever this is supposed to be, the second coming of Christ, basically. But it's not supposed, it's too early. So they're like, fuck, is this him? Like, we don't really know. So it's so cool, dude. I love it.
I'm pretty sure Josh Brolin's still alive. I think as big of an actor as Josh Brolin is and how he was kind of like general or someone high up, I think if he did die, you would see it. So
he's 100% not dead. 100%.
Yeah. He was so badass, like training the kid, Timothy or whatever his real name is.
Yeah.
And dude, like it still bothers me. Like, I know I told you on Halo, like a part of me wishes that the prince joined Jason Momoa and they like fought together in that narrow hallway because he's clearly a way better fighter than Jason Momoa. Like, he's been training for years in like close quarters to protect himself. But like, Jason Momoa closed the door purposely because he knew that he'd probably go and he didn't want any harm to potentially come to him.
Yeah, because Jason Momoa realizes he's just another soldier, but Paul is like potentially the leader of like the universe and the House of Atreides. He's the Duke, the leader now. Yeah, he's way too important. Yeah, Josh Brolin's definitely not dead. 100% not dead. The one thing too, I don't know if you realize this. So it says it takes place in the year 10,191. So that's not like our years. So it actually takes place in like 23,000 our time. And what happened is in the year, I don't know, it was like 8,000 or something, our time, there was something called like the Space Guild that came into our like universe or whatever. And that's what spice is, dude. Spice isn't fuel. It's like some sort of mystical, like it is spice, but it's like a mystical thing that these aliens take at the Spacing Guild. And they're the ones that are almost like flight control navigators for interstellar travel. So like, they're the ones that are controlling the light speed and making sure that things don't crash into each other.
What are they like snorting? What is it, like speed? Alien speed?
Dude, it's like cocaine for like flight navigators, but that's really what it is. So
they're like, no, it's not illegal. Like, it helps us do our job better.
That's it, dude. They're like, if we can't snort spice, like, yeah, you guys aren't fucking flying anywhere.
So then the Furman people are absorbing the spice, like what, through the water and the food in the planet?
It's just unintentional. Like, they're just a group of nomadic people that settled on Dune to get away from like persecution, stuff like that. They're like, hey, listen, like, we found a planet that nobody will ever come to, and they settled there and they survived and they became in harmony with the sandworms and stuff like that. And then people were like, yo, that planet's full of that shit that we need for interstellar travel. So all of these planets starts going there and they're like, what the fuck? Like, we ran away from you guys. So they've gone underground now and they built these societies to survive, where then now House Atreides and House Harkin and all these other houses have come to Dune or to Arrakis to get the spice. The Fremen have been there the whole time being like, you come and you go. Just like Afghanistan. It's like, oh, the Russians are here now? Come on. Oh, the Americans are here now? Come on. Like, we've been here. We know what this fucking place is.
Yeah. Okay, so I told you there was a surprise that I had like 2 weeks ago. The surprise was supposed to be that I bought the book and I wanted to read it.
Oh.
Drastically underestimated the length. The book's like 700 pages, first of all.
Yeah.
And I did the math. I was like, okay, I have 2 weeks. That's like 40-ish pages a day. I'll do 20 in the morning, 20 at night. And then when I didn't even realize it, we have to obviously record before we release. And I was like, it's impossible. I can't. Even the audiobook is like 22 hours.
Well, Kyle MacLachlan, the actor that played Paul in the 1984 version, he had said, he's like, I basically read the book like 5 times. He's like, I read it once, had no idea what was going on, reread it again, still had no idea. And he's just like, it's so confusing and so vast that like, you probably wouldn't rereading pages, dude. Like,
I would like to, like, I want to know what happened. I have to know what happens in the second one, or like the second half of part. I can't wait like a whole year.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think I'm gonna end up having to read something too, because like, yeah, I need to know, man. I can't wait 2 years.
Yeah, it's just so interesting. Like, the guy in it, Javier Bardem.
Oh yeah.
How he was like the leader of at least that little nomadic tribe of them, and then mm-hmm. his the guy Jamis.
Yeah, dude. Yeah.
He was clearly in charge, Javier, but like they kind of, you're allowed to like speak up and like use, I guess like codes of the community, which is why he wanted to fight Timothy. And he was like, well, you know, like if you say you want to fight, like I have to allow you to fight. But it was so funny. Like he was arguing with him, kind of like they were in a relationship. He was like, you do this every time, Jamis. He's like, not again, Jamis. Yeah.
Like, don't do this, Jamis. And he's like, fuck you.
Jamis, don't.
Don't do this, Jamis.
It's cool, though, how Timothy's or Paul, like his abilities, they're kind of always a little off, you know?
Yeah,
like
I love that.
When he touched the wall, like he knew they were going to fight, but he saw himself die, which would probably be super creepy to see yourself die and then go into a fight.
I thought about that, man. I thought about that exact scene and what was being said, because like you see him, he watches Jamis kill him, and he's just like, in order for whatever the Messiah to rise, Paul Atreides must die. And it's like, to take a life is to take your own. So I was like, okay, so they're basically saying you got to kill this guy for in order for you to become the Messiah. And in killing him, you're basically taking your previous life and leaving it behind, because it's the first time you've ever killed a man. So you're killing, you're taking a life, which is killing your previous self. And now you can rise to be the Messiah. That's what I took from it.
Yeah. That, I mean, that's why he told his mom, like, we have to stay with these people and stay on Dune, because like my true path is here. Realistically, he should probably try and get back to his home planet and like tell people about what's going on.
No way, dude. Imagine, Justin, like imagine you're having nothing but dreams about this place and they're all starting to come true. Would you be like, all right, now let's go to a place where I've not been thinking about, not been having dreams? You would follow your dreams at that point, dude. I feel like
maybe.
Come on, dude. If like imagine like every time you fall asleep, you basically see what happens the next day, and then some variation of that happens. You wouldn't be like, okay, there's something I need to be following right now.
I mean, maybe, but I did think it was cool how he saw Shani.
Yeah.
Like perfectly, like, because all the other people that he dreamed about, like when he saw the vision of Jamis, like he had already met Jamis. He never met that girl, but saw her face perfectly, you know?
Well, he never met Jamis either. And he saw his face perfectly too. What do you mean?
Well, no, when he had the vision of Jamis fighting, they were already there.
No, dude. So he had the vision of Jamis on the plane. He had a vision of Jamis being like a spiritual leader. He's like, I'm going to show you the ways of the desert. And that was before they even found any of the Fremen. They even got chased or anything.
Oh, damn.
And okay. Dude, and then this is what's even crazier. So he has the vision of him and Jamis. Like, Jamis is like, hey, I'm your friend. I'm going to show you the ways of the desert, blah, blah, blah. Then he actually meets Jamis, and Jamis is a bad guy. So it's like, okay, it's not all there. So then he has to kill Jamis. And then he has another vision when he's sitting there with Rebecca Ferguson, and he's just like, I see me, and they're killing in my father's name. And it's like him and Chani standing over Caladan looking down at like a war going on, and Jamis is in the background. So it's like, all of these visions are not 100% correct. They're like dreams. They're just dreams, you know?
Well, there was something, I'm not sure if I read it or they have some kind of ability to bring people back. Did you see something like that?
No.
I could be wrong, but I could have sworn I read a comment that said like, oh, Jason Momoa is not actually dead. Like they have something that they can bring him back or something. I'm not positive on that one. You know, who knows? But I did think it was cool how he looked down and he saw like Stigar and the other people like fighting for him, you know, like in the vision when they came up from the sand and they were attacking that other army, but they were all working together as one. Like it was cool because now they're all, I'm curious to see what their new goal is.
Well, dude, the Fremen, it's like basically, it's like all these missionaries are going down there telling them about the Christ and the second coming of Christ, and now it's actually happening because they all are like they're yelling their sacred word at him right as he lands, and he's like they're superstitious, they believe what they've been told to believe, all of this stuff, and they think he is their Messiah from another world. And then things start happening, like that one woman who's like their doctor, Dr. Kine, she says to him, like, hey, how did you know how to like put your boots on this way? And he's like, it's just felt like the right way to do. And he's like, he will know your ways before you
Yeah.
tame him.
If you notice, there were like at least five or more of those like sayings where they were like quoting something about when you would meet the Messiah to the Messiah, you know?
Yeah,
There was
dude.
a lot of that, and that was cool. Like everyone, like all the Furman people kind of knew it was him, but they never directly were like, oh, you're the Messiah. They would just say some quote, you know, and
Right.
that's how you knew they knew it. I mean, dude, it was just so well done. Just so
Yeah,
good.
there's so much to talk about with it too, and obviously the music was so freaking cool, dude. Completely drew me into this world. I loved it.
Yeah, it was like each different scene had music for it that matched perfectly. Like it almost was like I didn't even notice it was in the background because it just matched so perfectly with what I was watching.
Oh yeah. Oh my God, dude. Oh, yeah, everything worked so well in this. So I'm so happy the second part's coming. I'm definitely gonna read the first part now just to like know what's going on because I have to. The villain is amazing. Bill Skarsgård did such a good job playing this like disgusting evil guy.
Oh yeah.
Very reminiscent of like Star Wars in that way. And yeah, man, fuck. I feel like there's so much more to talk about.
Batista's like his like big dumb nephew who he's just like in charge of the
Yeah, I know. Yeah. He kind of reminded me of his Guardians of the Galaxy character a little bit, but
Yeah, he would say very like, "What are we gonna do, uncle?" And then I was joking with you about Javier Bardem and how he would be like, "We need more water." Like the water, he kept saying it. I'm like, why is he saying it
I don't really
like
know what their language is supposed to be based off. I'm imagining like Arabic maybe, but dude, that was so cool where he spits and I was like, "What?" And then
There's
it's
a
like,
sign of respect there,
"Dude, I loved that." It's like, "Oh, he's giving up part of his moisture." I was like, "That's fucking crazy." And then the machines that they built, the suits where it like absorbs your perspiration and
yeah.
your sweat, your tears, and it made me think. I
It's
was like,
kind of gross. It's kind of gross. They're like, oh, so you're drinking like your nut sweat.
Well, it's also even grosser because it's like they take dead bodies. When somebody dies, they take their moisture. So like
Ew.
imagine like, Eric had a rough night with the White Claws and he died. And
Like,
it's
oh, this Eric kind of tastes like mango.
like, oh, it's like a blackberry White Claw. So I don't know. I was just thinking like that's kind of gross that like forever it's the same sweat and tears and perspiration that's just getting like recycled into your body. But
Yeah, pretty gross. Like they could have easily just been like, oh, when we put a little spice in there, it like cleans the sweat or something like that. But they're like, no, we just drink like ass sweat.
it's like, you gotta do what you gotta do. You gotta do what you
water.
gotta do. Well, I guess I don't know. You got any last minute thoughts on Dune?
Dude, I feel like I have so many thoughts. It got an 8.3 on IMDb, and before I forget really quickly, we had talked about how the first original one flopped really bad. I'm not sure how old this internet page that I'm looking at is, but it said as of whenever this was written, worldwide box office, 292 million and change. And it seems like a lot.
Yeah, I think they're doing fine at this point. I mean, it's already greenlit, so it's good to go, you know.
Yeah, do you think IMDb's 8.3 was fair?
I mean, I'd go higher, man, honestly. I'd probably go in like the I'd like nine, mid nines, I'd say.
Yeah, I would somewhere between 9 and 9.5. Yeah, it was that
I mean, I literally can't think of a better film I've seen in so long. Like, literally, I can't remember, dude. Like, of this magnitude, like a sci-fi blockbuster action or whatever it is, really, I just can't remember the last time I've seen one that I've enjoyed so much.
Even my favorite movies, dude, I don't think I've ever seen my favorite movies 2 days in a row. So yeah, it was good. Out of 10, I would say, yeah, probably closer to 9.5
Yeah.
Keanu's and yeah.
Yeah, man, I'm all about it. I'm all about it. Cannot wait for the series to continue. I hope it can maintain its steam it's got now. I think the Denis Villeneuve guy is doing the next one, so I'm hoping we're in a good place with this franchise. No more
Yeah.
Star Wars shit.
And I'm going to start, start the book. And that way, you know, if I only read like 20 pages a day, cause dude, it's a massive book.
Yeah. Well, I'm hoping that Eric will watch it and be like, dude, I want to talk about it. So we'll, you know, watch, or we can maybe do another episode on this at some point just to talk about more of it, I guess. Cause there's so much.
Yeah, and I also wanted to see it in IMAX. I was way too impatient. Like when I found out that it was on HBO, I was like, okay, I'm watching it on HBO first.
I know.
And then I probably should have just gone to IMAX by myself, to be honest. Like I wanted to see it that bad.
I'm right there with it at this point. Yeah.
Anything else to comment on it?
No. I think I hit all my major points. So.
All right. Awesome.
Well, I guess we will release our next, because we're going to have another film coming out in 2 weeks from today. So we'll pick one of the newest films and we'll have something special to tell you about that one, I guess.
Yeah, I have no idea which one. There's so many. Maybe people can comment like, do you want to do the new Bond, which is supposed to be Daniel Craig's last one? Oh, there's Venom 2, but I feel like if you're not a superhero fan, you might not like it. And then there's definitely something else coming out. There's a lot right now.
Well, we'll talk about it and we'll look for like the biggest, newest movie and we'll share it on Twitter and Instagram and all that stuff once we've decided. But it'll be soon. We'll pick one soon.
Alrighty.
All right. Well, thank you so much for listening in on our discussion about Dune, and we'll see you in 2 weeks with an undisclosed brand new streaming movie. And also don't forget to check out Wheel of Horror, which is airing this Monday with Evil Dead 2.
See ya.